Thank you very much again, Bhaskaran. It's been a great 2 days, and I really have enjoyed being here. And it's been a fantastic meeting where I got to learn a lot. And I really thank Bhaskaran and his team for actually making it happen. Okay, take care. Frequency mismatch. No, yesterday was okay. No waves now, so. Yeah, great. Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah, now it's still starting.
Okay, so I will discuss a little bit of what we have done in dynamic DMRG methods while giving an introduction to various other methods that have been used, that are being used both at present and that have been used in the past. This one, I started doing some dynamic work basically in the frequency space with exact diagonalization with Zoltan Shosh, and then my former student Swapan Pathe and one of my colleagues postdocs and one of my former students Tirthankar Datta. These were the people who have always been there, and of course Krishnamurthy was a person who was instrumental in my starting work in density matrix renormalization group. Okay, now let's come to what are the things that we are going to study. Dynamic response to external perturbations, and the response can be viewed as a function of frequency or as a function of time. So you can either do the responses in the frequency domain or you can do it in the time domain. The two are related, and you can actually compute one from the other, but it is easier said than done. So it's better if you want to do something in frequency domain, do it in the frequency domain, and if you want something in time domain, do it separately in the time domain. The unperturbed Hamiltonian we are having is an interacting Hamiltonian, which is either the Hubbard model or the Pariser-Park-Popel model for molecules. And of course in physics it's basically Hubbard Hamiltonian, Heisenberg spin Hamiltonians, and many of their variants like the Kondor Hamiltonian and UV models and so forth. But in chemistry you have to have long-range interacting models, and we discussed the Pariser-Park-Popel model. And the way it is solved is using restricted configuration interactions. So you have matrices like the single CI matrix, single and double CI matrix, which actually define the Hamiltonian in many contexts, and we want to obtain the dynamics of such Hamiltonian matrices. Well, computing dynamic response involves actually computing this I of omega, which is a response to some external perturbation, and the response operator is O. For example, if you are applying an electric field, the response operator O is the dipole operator, because if you are doing the calculation in the electric dipole approximation, then this is what you will be worried about. And H is the Hamiltonian matrix or Hamiltonian operator. And we are interested in obtaining I omega as a function of frequency omega for any perturbation, and O is the response operator. This can be solved by the Lanczos scheme, which was the one that was used by physicists for a long time. And there is also the sum of all states technique, which has been the favored technique for most of the quantum chemistry community. And then we introduced a technique called the correction vector technique in 88 sometime. And this is way more accurate than either the Lanczos technique or the sum of all states technique. And I'll just discuss these techniques a little bit in detail. Well, about the Lanczos method. So supposing I give you any operator or a matrix, like the Hamiltonian matrix or the Hamiltonian operator, then you can start operating that with the operator on some arbitrary state phi naught, then obtain a state phi 1, again operate on that with the Hamiltonian and so forth. So basically you are actually constructing what is called a Krylov space, and within that space you get a tridiagonal representation of the Hamiltonian matrix, which is actually, because Hamiltonian is Hermitian. If you have a Hermitian operator, you get the tridiagonal representation of the operator in the Lanczos scheme.
So it's a mini body Hamiltonian.
It's a mini body Hamiltonian. So all that you are doing is you start with the state phi naught. So maybe, if you have got large U, then you take one of the spin paired states on neighboring sides as a starting point, apply with the Hamiltonian. Then you pick up a coefficient corresponding to this state, which is diagonal. And the off-diagonal part would correspond to a vector which is orthogonal to the initial starting vector. Now you operate again on H of P1 and so forth. So it's basically some kind of a power technique. Okay? And so you can get the Hamiltonian matrix. Basically, you have these diagonal elements C0, C1, Cn, and D1, D2, etc. You truncate it then. And of course, there are people who truncate just at n equal to 2 and keep reiterating. So it is the modified Langevin scheme, and the iterations are much easier to do, and it will take longer to converge, but nonetheless the convergence can be attained. So this is basically the Langevin scheme. You are going to get a tridiagonal Hamiltonian matrix starting with some arbitrary state. Now you obtain the ground state of this Hamiltonian. Okay, there's a lowest energy state psi naught, and you construct this state O operating upon psi naught as the state which is just psi naught and which is normalized. So this is the normalization of this state O psi naught, and let me call this state phi naught. Okay. Now what we will do is we do one more Langevin on the same thing. So start with phi naught. That is, you first obtain the ground state psi naught. From psi naught you construct phi naught, and then you again do the Langevin procedure. So once you do the Langevin procedure, then you get a different Langevin matrix. And let me call, and the difference Langevin matrix that I get will be like this: A0, A1, A n, An, B1, B2, B3, Bn. Okay? So this is a different Langevin matrix compared to the Langevin matrix that we got first, starting with some arbitrary state. Okay? So it is important to start with this particular state phi naught, which is O times psi naught. Now let me go through a little bit of algebra. So,
when you say you start with an arbitrary state,
yeah,
like yesterday you started with arbitrary product states,
yeah,
and the operator will be to the minus beta. Do you have initial bias or you start?
So, actually, you can do an initial bias. So, you look at, for example, diagonally dominant Hamiltonians, these are usually. So, you take the the state for which the diagonal matrix element is largest or the smallest, you take that state as the initial starting state and then do the calculation. Okay, so either you can do it that way, or you can do with some linear combination of all the covalent states if you are dealing with a U large, and there are many other ways. It's a matter of trial and error, and it does not make a great deal of difference as long as you are somewhere close by. Okay, specific things are not so important when you are doing this. These are extremely stable calculations. So let me go through this. So let us look at this matrix Zi minus HL. So this is, of course, the Zi minus HL inverse, and when you multiply the two, you get the identity operator. So that is obvious. Now let me write down the mnth element of this matrix multiplication, which is MP times PN, the Zi minus HL and Zi minus H inverse. Okay. Now let me take just n equal to 0. So when I take n equal to 0, and if I define my matrix elements in the pth row as this is the zeroth column, right? Because this is a zeroth column and pth row index is changing. So if I say XP as Zi minus HL inverse P0, then you will see you get a set of linear equations. Zi minus HL MP times XP is delta M0. Now, from these equations, we solve for X0. So what is X0 in this case? X0 is this quantity, phi naught 1 upon Zi minus HL phi naught, because phi naught was a starting vector, and this Zi minus HL inverse is what I am taking. So this term phi naught 1 upon Zi minus HL phi naught is what we are going to get as X0, and this is, if I were to write it in terms of the ground state, I started with psi 0, then I have psi 0 O dagger 1 upon Zi minus HL O psi 0 divided by phi naught to the power half, and this is the response function that we were looking for. So X0 is nothing but the response function. And to calculate, so you are given the new Hamiltonian matrix HL starting with this phi naught vector, and you have all this tridiagonal matrix. From the tridiagonal matrix, you can solve for X0 by using solving this set of equations by plugging in what is Zi minus HL and you solve this set of equations, then what you will get is a continued fraction solution. So the continued fraction solution is minus 1 upon pi imaginary part of this one, z minus a naught b1 squared, etc., etc. So this is the technique that was used, that was first developed by, I think, Fulday, and later on applied to DMRG by Karen in 1995. So this was, she applied it to Heisenberg spin chain, and she studied this one. And the advantage is that, you know, once you get this matrix, you can keep changing z value and then obtain I omega corresponding to whatever z that you want, because z is nothing but E naught plus h cos omega plus I epsilon.
DMRG has not come in so far.
DMRG has come in because Karen Halberg did this calculation. In my presentation, the DMRG has come in simply because the Hamiltonian matrix that I started with can be a DMRG Hamiltonian matrix. Okay, so this Hamiltonian matrix that I had, for which I get the tri-diagonal form, this can be the DMRG, you can construct this from the DMRG matrix. So if you are given the DMRG matrix in whatever basis, the DMRG basis, you can construct a tri-diagonal matrix, which is the Lanczos, and then you can do all the steps that I told you in order to get the frequency-dependent response. So that's what actually Karen did for the DMRG, within the DMRG framework. So she started with the DMRG matrix, obtained the tri-diagonal form, obtained the ground state, and from the ground state, she started with a new function, and constructed this matrix, and from this matrix as a continued fraction, she got the response functions. Okay, so this was just straightforward extension of the DMRG method to this one. Lanczos is really fast. The numerically it is fast, because once you get the Lanczos matrix, then you can keep plugging in different frequencies and get the entire spectrum I of omega. It is quite straightforward. But in quantum chemistry literature, people have to calculate I omega. Like, for example, you want to calculate polarizabilities, or you want to calculate nonlinear polarizabilities, and so forth. So when you want to do that, what people do is just introduce some of the states, you know, dissolve the, use the identity operator here in terms of the eigenstates of the Hamiltonian, and then you can just write down the whole, this expression I of omega in this form, which is just psi 0 O dagger, excited state O psi 0 divided by the energy denominator. So this is going to give you the I of omega response function. And what people used to do in quantum chemistry techniques was what was called the sum over states technique. In the sum over states technique, you are given the Hamiltonian matrix, you obtain many eigenstates, usually about 100 or 200 or whatever it is, the number of eigenstates, obtain the matrix element psi 0 O dagger, this is the excited state that you have got, and then explicitly form this summation. Of course, this is an uncontrolled approximation, there is a truncation involved, and incidentally, even in the Lanczos scheme, there is a truncation involved over and above the DMRG truncation, because the DMRG matrices are usually of the order of about 100,000 or 200,000 by 200,000 kind of matrices, because if you keep a DMRG cutoff of like 500, then you will have a really huge space, because it is 16 times 500 squared. So that is something like 4 million. And even if you specialize the case to a Hilbert space that you want, from the 4 million, you are going to have maybe at least 500,000 or a million by million matrix. And the Lanczos matrix that you are going to construct is typically about 1,000 by 1,000 matrix. So from something like 1 million states, you have actually truncated to about 1,000 states. So there's a truncation involved even in the Lanczos scheme. And in this scheme, the truncation is even more severe, because it's very difficult to keep 1,000 states, obtain 1,000 excited states.
So, Ramesh, you don't actually need all the excited states. Like, for example, if this O has some dipole selection rule of some sort, then I will only need those excited states.
Correct. Coupled. Correct. But the point is that when you have the, even those spaces are pretty huge. Okay? Because if you have a 1 million states, then the dipole selection rule is going to break it up only into about 500,000 and 500,000. Okay, because you have the one which is odd under inversion and one which is even under inversion is what you're going to look at. So in the 1988 sometime, we developed a technique called the correction vector technique. And correction vector technique is, you know, like a Green's function technique, if you want to look at it, or, you know, people have these kinds of equations. So what you need is you define a correction vector phi 1 omega as the solution of this linear algebraic equation, inhomogeneous algebraic equation. On the left side is your operator, which comes under the denominator, which is h minus e naught minus h cos omega minus I epsilon. Operating upon phi 1 omega is going to give you O times psi naught. Psi naught is a ground state, you know the ground state. O is your desired operator, it may be a dipole operator or whatever other operator you have. And so O times psi 0 is known. What is not known is phi 1 omega. And let us look at what phi 1 omega is actually. So if phi 1 omega is expanded in the eigenstates of H, then I can actually expand phi 1 omega as sum over R coefficient CR times R. Okay, supposing I were to, because I'm not going to compute the eigenstates per se, but I'm just trying to see what these coefficients look like. And I can calculate these coefficients, and these coefficients turn out to be RO psi naught divided by the energy denominator. This is one chunk that actually I want to compute in computing the response functions. So if I were to solve for phi 1 omega, then phi 1 omega will be this coefficient times the excited state R. So I already have this coefficient present in the, this term present in the correction vector phi 1 omega. So if I want to look at just I omega, it is just minus 1 by pi imaginary part of psi ground state O phi 1 omega. So if I were to solve for phi 1 omega, then I'll get this response function without having to go through the excited states. So this is an extremely accurate method, and what happens is that this phi 1 omega implicitly contains all the excitations of the Hamiltonian. There is no truncation in over and above the DMRG truncation, or if you are doing an exact diagonalization scheme, then it is the exact quantity that you will get I omega. It's the exact response of the state. So there is no truncation whatsoever. And of course, Hamiltonian can be in any chosen basis, like the DMRG basis or the VB basis or the Slater determinants or whatever that you want. And solving for phi 1 omega is that just assume that phi 1 omega can also be expanded in the basis of in the basis vectors k. Like the basis vectors can be either the DMRG, the VB, or the Slater determinant basis vectors. And we can write down the equation for phi 1 omega as some AC times B, where A is a matrix which is just given by this E naught plus H cos omega I epsilon delta ij minus Hij. And Bi is nothing but sigma or j Oij Aj, where psi 0, the ground state, is given by Aj times j. So these quantities are known, Aij is known, Bi is known. And what I really want to do is solve for the vector C. Now, if I know the vector C, I know phi 1 omega, and I can calculate the response.
So there's nothing like you had truncation in the previous.
Yeah, there's no truncation in this one.
There was some approximation.
The approximation is in terms of the Hamiltonian that you have chosen. That is, the DMRG Hamiltonian is an approximate Hamiltonian. So supposing, see, I have been able to do up to 16 sites, you know, Hubbard or Paris or Park Popple, which is exact response functions. There is no approximation whatsoever. Okay, so 16 site problem has about how much? Some 27 million excited states or something like that. Okay, and all the 27 million excited states are taken into account in computing phi 1. Phi 1 omega. Yeah, but the point is solving these equations is a little tricky. So you have to use, I developed a method called the small matrix algorithm, which is very similar to Davidson algorithm. Okay, so all the errors that you are going to have are only numerical, not the truncation errors. So in that you can do this solving AC equal to B by using the Davidson algorithm, which is very similar to the Davidson algorithm, except that instead of using, you use the residue vector and then you weight it according to the diagonal element and then expand your space. You know, just as, because Davidson algorithm, I don't know how many of you people know about Davidson algorithm. It is just a combination of Lanczos algorithm and what was called the coordinate relaxation algorithm or the steepest descent algorithm. And you can, here, it is combination of Gauss-Seidel iterative scheme and a Lanczos scheme to obtain the solution for AC equal to B. It's pretty fast, extremely fast algorithm. Only thing is that when the frequency omega is negative, then it is not going to converge, because just as Gauss-Seidel iterative scheme also does not converge when you have negative frequencies or when the matrix for which you are solving is not positive definite. So you can make this positive definite by actually multiplying on both sides by A transpose, so that A transpose A C is equal to A transpose B, and A transpose A is always a positive definite matrix. And so it is possible to solve this using these kinds of algorithms. Well, the interesting thing, so with this you can get, if O is a dipole displacement operator, then you can get the polarizability by frequency dependent polarizability by these kinds of expressions, which is similar to optical conductivities. Okay, because there you do the current-current correlation functions, and here you are doing the dipole-dipole correlation functions. And to obtain, you can also obtain higher order nonlinear response. For example, here mu I is the ith component of the dipole. So I have in this case phi 1 omega means the ith component of the dipole operator is what I have used for computing phi 1 omega, and mu j is the jth component of the dipole operator, so this gives me the ijth component of the this thing, polarizability tensor. And I can get the higher order tensors by concentrating on phi ij 2 omega, which is again very similar to the equation that I wrote down, except that instead of the ground state I have phi ij omega 1. So it's a hierarchy of equations. When I use this hierarchy of equations, then I can calculate phi ij 2 omega 1 comma omega 2, and then I can get the nonlinear polarizability corresponding to the third order, which is gamma ijkl, as sum over intrinsic permutation symmetry operator, phi I omega 1, mu j, phi kl, minus omega 1, minus omega 2, and minus omega 1. So this way you can calculate the quantities. And I just want to show you that we did this.
Just a quick question.
Yeah.
So this gamma ijkl you already written, right?
Yeah.
Just doing the
Kubo-Marge scheme, what is important is how do you actually construct your Hamiltonian matrix for obtaining good response functions. So to get good response functions, the Hamiltonian matrix that you have to construct should also contain, the reduced density matrix should contain phi 1 omega.
No.
See, I mean, I don't know. I don't.
This is also related to.
Yeah, just a second.
You had before.
Yeah.
What is real normalization
here? We have obtained a real normalized Hamiltonian.
Okay, so how does it look like? Suppose you go back to the old basis.
Okay, so let me see. Okay, so if I go back to the old basis, the real normalized Hamiltonian is basically you have the Hamiltonian matrix H, Hamiltonian operator H, operating upon mu sigma sigma prime mu prime, nu tau tau prime nu prime. Okay, and what I have is rho left nu is equal to some rho nu and rho right nu prime is equal to some rho nu prime. So these are basically the density matrix eigenvectors. Okay? Right? And the density matrix eigenvectors are actually, if I'm looking at density matrix eigenvector in the first stage, okay? For a
The
hopping term has got modified in the following sense. Okay.
It doesn't generate long range hopping.
No, it does not generate long range hopping. The only way the hopping term has come into picture is the following. That is, look at, for example, your Hamiltonian was A dagger I, AI plus 1, sigma sum over I comma sigma plus Hermitian conjugate, right? So you have some T. So now this A dagger I, AI plus 1 is now expressed as a matrix in the mu nu basis. And you don't do anything to T. Okay. So for example, suppose.
Like when you do RG in statistical mechanics, like Lysing,
yeah.
You start with the nearest hybrid interaction and do one decimation.
Yeah.
Generate next layer is like so on. So you generate a whole class of coupling bars.
Yeah.
So something like that must be happening.
See, the coupling constants in our case are nothing but the Hamiltonian matrix elements.
But that's too general.
No, just a minute. Because the only thing that you are working with are matrices. So every time you are transforming the matrix. Okay? So you start with a matrix, which is...
So you don't take effort to go back to the site basis?
No. The site basis, site operators are now expressed as matrices again in the DMR, in the density matrix eigenvectors.
But in principle, it's possible to go back.
It is possible to go back. So when you go back, that is when you get the matrix product states. Yeah, because the matrix product states are written in terms of the raw basis, like sigma 1, sigma 2, etc. And
I
then
remember, there was a very early work by Borges.
Yeah.
He wanted to apply RG2 compartment.
Yeah.
He did some kind of very simple bond-moving thing. And he did generate some T prime. And also some extra there is no such.
No, there is no such. See, when you are actually doing the energy-based calculations, the DMRG, which used to happen before, so you would have some three sites here and some three sites here, sorry, and you will replace them by a new site.
Right. Then how can you say?
And the interaction between the new sites will involve hopping of the long range. And so it will involve hopping from, for example, this site to this site. Okay, because the eigenstate consists of all the things. But here in this case, what you are doing is not that one. You are only replacing the Fock space by the density matrix eigenvectors. And since you are truncating the Fock space, here the, using the density as the criterion, so you get a same dimensional Fock space every time, independent of the size of the system. And for every site operator that you have can now be rewritten in terms of the Fock space that you have chosen at that time.
So in your language, in the usual RG, you have the notion of fixed point.
Yeah.
So is there a notion of fixed point here in the sense you have the density matrix doesn't change? Does it happen in practice?
Well, at least as far as I can see, I don't see the notion of a fixed point in this case, and maybe Sukhvinder can say better. In the infinite case, the Hamiltonian matrix that you get is not going to change any further, the matrix elements. But, yeah. But usually you never go up to that point, because what you are actually doing is do a calculation for 300 or 400 sites, and by then you have already converged. So the change is small.
But when you sweep, right, I mean, based on what you have learned from.
Yeah.
After a while, the ground state doesn't change, right? So that, in a sense, is a fixed point.
I mean, eigenstates are fixed points. If you want to look at eigenstates of the infinite Hamiltonian are the fixed points, and we are actually driving the eigenstate to that particular fixed point. So, and from that point of view, the Hamiltonian matrix, at least for the ground state, will give the same ground state. But whether the entire Hamiltonian matrix itself remains the same, I don't know.
Yeah.
Because the ground state, see, what you are homing in on is the ground state only.
Right.
So the Hamiltonian matrix elements can change, but still the ground state need not change. So I don't know whether...
just to follow from Bhaskar's point, so in a sense that every state and simply doing a new unitary transformation of the Hamiltonian to some new basis.
Yeah.
So it's not really changing any magnitude of any coupling constant in any...
Well, what are coupling constants? Coupling constants are your Hamiltonian parameters, T, the transfer integrals, right? So now once you truncate the space, then the Hamiltonian matrix elements change. So you are changing the coupling constants. So in that sense, you are changing the coupling constants, but you are not focusing on this one. You know, like, see, in the RG of this thing, Wilson's RG or whatever it is, you are having your partition function, you want to keep it the same, right? It should not change. So that's what you are looking for. But here you don't have any such restriction. So there you are.
In fact, according to there is a restriction. Suppose you have a set of operators O and up to O, and you take an expectation. Now you modify, you do a renormalization, and then it modifies the states, and then corresponding to the operators. So numerically, these two things should be the same. So O prime, expectation value, psi prime, should be equal to O, psi, psi.
Mm.
So I demand equality of some observable, then calculate.
But
so That is how they define relocalization.
But what we are doing is we are adding the sites. Mm-hmm. So what is the operator over that you are going to look at? Because you are generating new operators when you add new sites. Right? So I do not know that. See, I only know the working principle behind it, but I do not know exactly what the flow diagrams are for these things, because I don't know whether anybody has worked out the RG flow diagrams for the DMRG case. Yeah, I have also not seen anybody having done that. So
it may be good to study in some solvable models, because there may be more, some insights may come. Mm. So here, as somebody said, the computer...
No, but people did do the solvable models. For example, the uniform Hubbard model and the uniform spin-half Heisenberg chain. Mm. But they have not, as far as I know, they have not looked at the flow. What they were actually looking at was either the excitation spectrum or the ground state energy per site.
So you are pragmatic.
Calculate things.
Maybe some of these issues can be a talk.
So the important thing is, when you actually construct the density matrices, you must take the density matrices to have representation of the phi 1 omega, that is a response function. So what you do is you take the ground state density matrix and the density matrix corresponding to phi 1 omega and take the average of those. So you get an average reduced density matrix and do the calculation. And when you use that average density matrix, then the phi 1 omega has a very good representation in the space, and so your accuracy goes up. The point is, this method is far more accurate than the Lanczos scheme, except that is much more compute intensive, because you will have to do separate calculations, solve the AX equal to B kind of inhomogeneous linear equations for every frequency omega. And this involves, this can be pretty time consuming. And particularly for negative frequencies, the time taken is far more, because you are going to be solving something like A transpose A, X is equal to A transpose B. So it's a far more involved calculation. So this is something that for Hubbard and Parizer-Power-Popple kind of models, we developed this technique in 88, because we were interested in nonlinear optics at that time, and later on used same procedure for the DMRG calculations. And I just want to show you how good the DMRG is. So here I have these isotropic tensors of the second and the fourth ranks here. I have just averaged them over all the angles, because that's what you actually measure. And you see that for a 12 site U by T equal to 4, the exact value of alpha is 5.343 in 10 to the minus 24 ESU, and alpha bar DMRG is 5.317, and gamma exact is 598.3, 591.1. And in fact, if you look at the components, the dominant components are showing much better equalities. So, for example, the dominant component is 14.83 for alpha XX, and DMRG is 14.81. These are the exact numbers you can get. And similarly, gamma is 2873 versus 2872, is embarrassingly extremely close. So this method has now become fairly common practice, because what happened was, after we published our work, then there was also a paper by White and Kuhner, who also showed that for their use it was good. And then Jekyllman and others have now, people in the DMRG community use routinely the correction vector technique instead of the Lanczos technique for calculating the response functions. And here are some results for different values of U by T as a function of length. And you see that when U by T is large, then there is going to be a saturation in the gamma values much more rapidly. So looks like the correlations tend to suppress the fluctuations which are responsible for dipole oscillations.
Your method, this correction method, is it being used by people who want to calculate electron spectral functions in RPS? Because they have very similar things. You have seen that at
Yeah, correct.
So do they use this method? There are lots of numerical efforts also.
Yeah, but I have not seen that. I have not kept track of that one.
My old methods used to do like chemistry,
sir. Some old states. Some old states is an extremely uncontrolled approximation.
So people may not be familiar with
this. But this one is using a DMRG. Since you get it for all the excitations of the DMRG space that you have chosen, so these are extremely accurate functions, accurate values. So here is some other results for value of gamma average as a function of for the UV models. And since I'm focusing more on the method, I don't want to go into that one. So I'll just give you a brief summary of what the frequency space DMRG technique is. You can compute all the response functions within the DMRG scheme. The main methods are the Lanczos method and the correction vector method. Lanczos method is less accurate but fast, but correction vector method is very accurate but compute intensive. And you can go to higher orders much more easily in case of correction vector methods compared to the Lanczos method, because with the correction vector methods you can go to second order response, third order response and so forth, so much more easily. Exactly the same formalism will work. Now I'll go into real-time dynamics, and in real-time dynamics what we really need to do is to solve the time-dependent Schrodinger equation I h cross delta psi by delta t equal to h psi. So this is what everybody knows, and what we do is we start with some wave packet psi. For example, depending upon the problem that you are looking at, we could probably start with, in our case we have started with a wave packet which is a ground state ground state wave function which has been doped by one hole, so at the site 1. So what you do is you take the ground state wave function and operate by A1G, which is actually annihilating the electron on site 1 with spin up, and that is equivalent to hole doping.
So this is like an arc wave, it's more than
electron. Yeah. But there you put it into the continuum in arc space and then you calculate all the matrix elements. But here you have just taken this wave packet. And we follow the evolution of psi under the this is action of the Hamiltonian, and basically because we are looking at interacting Hamiltonians, we always do this time evolution in Schrodinger representation. We don't want to do this time evolution in Heisenberg or the interaction representation, because interaction representation requires knowing all the eigenstates of the non-interacting, of the unperturbed Hamiltonian. So because you have this term omega ij coming when you write down the equation for the coefficients. So in order to avoid that, we work in the Schrodinger representation. And the time evolution operator is just given by this one, which is obvious. But when you want to solve it, you want to discretize it, because you always try to solve it in very short time steps, delta t, usually like 0.001 femtoseconds at a time. And so it takes a hell of a lot of time to actually propagate the wave function. And you use the Crank-Nicholson approximation for the time evolution operator, for infinitesimal time evolution operator t to t plus delta t. This can actually be understood in the following way. That is, I take the wave function at psi t plus delta t, backward propagate in time by delta t by 2, and I take the wave function psi t at time t and then forward propagate it by time delta t by 2. The two should be equal. So that's how I'm going to force unitarity on my wave function. On my time propagation operator, because unitarity is important, because you want to preserve the norm. Of course, you can also normalize it in some sense, but it is important to preserve the norm, and that's why you solve this equation. And if you express psi t plus delta t and psi t as well as the Hamiltonian in a certain basis, then once again this becomes nothing but a set of algebraic equations, Ax equal to b. B is the known thing on the right side, because you know the wave function at time t and you also know the Hamiltonian matrix. What is not known is the wave function at time t plus delta t, which is given by x, and of course you have the matrix 1 plus I h delta t by 2. So you want to solve this one, and once again you can use the same techniques for solving that, which is similar to the Davidson technique for obtaining the solution Ax equal to b. But this solving every time this linear algebraic equations is time consuming. So you want to make it go faster, and the way to do it is actually solve it using one of those multi-step differencing techniques. And in this one, what you do is you try to get an expression for e to the power minus I 2h delta t by h cross by actually doing just a Taylor series expansion. Once you make the Taylor series expansion and substitute for h squared in this one, then you operating on the initial state psi 0, you will get psi t plus 2 delta t is roughly equal to psi t minus 2 delta t minus of psi t minus delta t and psi t plus delta t. So if you know the wave function at times t minus delta t, t, t plus delta t and t minus 2 delta t, that is at 4 time slices, then you know how to go to the next time slice, which is t plus 2 delta t, because we are going from t plus delta t to t plus 2 delta t using information of the wave function at t plus delta t, t minus delta t, t and t minus 2 delta t. And this is very fast because it only involves one sparse matrix multiplication, and this is extremely accurate. Of course, Crank-Nicolson is also extremely accurate, and this is much, much faster technique. And once you propagate the wave function, then you can calculate all the time dependent quantities as expectation values of the desired operator O between the time dependent states psi t.
So the error here is delta t squared.
In this case, no, delta t to the power 4 or 5, something, delta t to the power 5. Because I'm going, see, look, it's a four step. T minus 2 delta t, t minus delta t, t and t plus delta t. Okay, so it must be of order delta t to the power 5. Okay. This is extremely fast. So if you are doing time evolution, probably this is a better way of actually going around. Okay, let's see which was the first time dependent calculation that was done, DMRG calculation. It was done by Casalia and Marston, and this was in the year 2002. So they were trying to actually look at the tunneling current between of just one interacting site between two leads. So that's what they were doing the calculation on. And they used the DMRG Hamiltonian with different cutoffs to study the tunneling between two Luttinger liquids. So basically you have two Luttinger liquids between which the tunneling is taking place. And they use, the only thing DMRG about this particular time evolution was that you use a DMRG Hamiltonian matrix. And they found that as a function of cutoff, the exact solution and the time-dependent DMRG solution, if you look at it, for small cutoffs, you know, at earlier times you started seeing deviations, and for large cutoffs it was reasonably okay. It was 28 time steps or something like that that they took, and it seemed to be working for short time evolutions. It is not good for long time evolutions, but definitely it was okay for short time evolutions. Then came the work of Liu, Xiang and Wang, which we call the LXW algorithm. What they said was, you can actually improve upon the whole thing by doing constructing a reduced average density matrix by taking time evolution at various steps. That is, supposing you want to go to, say, for example, a 10-site problem from the 8-site problem. You solve the 8-site problem and then time evolve it for all the times for which you want to study the 10-site problem. Once you have time evolved it, you know the wave function at different times. And now you construct the density matrix at each time. And then you average, construct an average density matrix by using certain weights. They use weight 1 half for the t equal to 0 solution and weight 1 by 2n for the remaining solutions. Okay, and then you construct an average reduced density matrix. Once you have the average reduced density matrix, then you can construct your Hamiltonian for the 10-site problem using this, and then do the time evolution. And this time evolution for the 10-site problem is going to be much more accurate because the 8-site problem density matrix from which you have constructed the 10-site Hamiltonian corresponds to all time steps that you are interested in. Because you are interested in all the time steps have been taken into account, this is going to be extremely accurate.
So and the big DMRG operation in time evolution.
Yeah. So what you do is, you, for the 8th step you have the Hamiltonian matrix. So you time evolve at T0, T1, T2, etc. and T and T, okay? And then you construct the density matrix for each of these times. And then you average the density matrix and then obtain the density matrix eigenvectors, and you use these density matrix eigenvectors to construct the 10-site Hamiltonian. So the density matrix eigenvectors now you have got has information about the later times, not just the t equal to 0. So the time evolution for the tensite problem is going to be much more accurate.
But, why is it working when I take alpha to be uniform? So for example, if there's a region in time where there's a fast evolution versus slow evolution,
yeah,
then I should weight that region more, right?
For those regions, you must have shorter time steps. And as far as the weighting is concerned, you know, it's a matter of, see, numerical analysis is an art. Okay, so you have to keep trying, okay, trial and error, and based on that, you find out which is the best one. So the guiding principle is if you know the exact solution, in, at least in some limits, then you will see how good your numerics is. Okay, so people have, we also have played around with these kinds of things, weights, okay, and we find that in this particular case, the weight is not too bad. Alpha equal to, for the time t equal to 0, weight of 1/2, and for the others, weight of 1 by 2n. Okay, so this is a matter of trying out. Most of the numerical analysis is like that. The main drawback is extremely time consuming. See, what they do in these cases is only infinite DMRG. They don't do the finite DMRG algorithm. And it's very time consuming because you have to time evolve at every size, system size. So if you want to know what the time evolution is for a 100 site problem and you start from a 4 site problem, you have to time evolve over all the steps at 4 sites, 6 sites, 8 sites, 10 sites, like that. So you are actually doing a lot of work in order to get the time evolution of the final problem, 100 site problem. And here they show the differences. You know, for example, they have taken some 24 time slices here, and they show that with the 24 time slices, the agreement is far better when you have actually weighted out your average density matrix and obtained a pretty good representation of the reduced density matrix for the next step. So you will get rid of all these spurious oscillations. So most of these oscillations are spurious, okay? And that's because the state is going out of the Hilbert space. Okay, and you do have oscillations which are actually genuine. These are the Rabi oscillations, but these are not the Rabi oscillations because these disappear when you do a much more accurate calculation. And then there was this technique due to Schmidt-Eckert based on what is called a Krylov space technique. What is Krylov space? Krylov space is nothing but you take your any vector x, and then you operate by Hamiltonian on that vector x, you generate a new vector. Make this new vector orthogonal to the old vector, then you have if the initial vector was x0, now you have x1. And then x2 you can get by operating on x1 and then making it orthogonal to x0 and x1. So like that you can generate a space which is obtained by actually operating by the Hamiltonian operator on a starting state repeatedly. Now what you can do is, you can obtain a matrix representation of your Hamiltonian in this particular space, and that becomes a Krylov space representation of your operator H. And in this one, what they did was also interesting. That is, they take the initial wave packet and they expand it in a few low-lying states of the Hamiltonian. So you are given the wave packet psi 0, and given the Hamiltonian, they also know the various low-lying eigenstates, maybe 5 or 10. So they know ground state, the first excited, the second excited, and so forth. So this wave packet psi 0 is first projected onto these states, which the ground state, the first excited, the second excited, and probably the 10th excited state. And only the residue is taken to use to evolve using the Krylov space technique. So because once you have the coefficient times an eigenstate, the time evolution of the eigenstate is trivial. And so only the residue needs to be time evolved, and they found that this technique was quite accurate. But what I know is that this method has not been very widely used. And then there was, yeah.
You are bringing this wave packet dynamics,
yeah,
with this spin charge coupling in Mahila.
Yeah, that is what we studied. Tirthankar studied spin.
You can give a motivation.
Yeah. Now, wave packet dynamics, you can study for various things. For example, you want to find out the tunneling current, how it varies with time. Supposing you are you start, it's basically non-equilibrium dynamics is what you are going to be worried about. Okay, so supposing I take two leads and the central site or whatever it is, and introduce a chemical potential difference between the two ends, then the electrons start flowing from one end to the other. So you want to find out the dynamics of the electron flow, or you want to find out the current. Okay, so that is one kind of problem that people have studied. Another kind of problem is what we have studied, which is spin charge separation as a function of correlation strengths and as a function of the range of correlations and so forth. So I will come to the other problem, but I thought I'll spend more time on the techniques, because people were more interested in the DMRG techniques. So that's why I'm focusing more on the techniques. And I want to give an introduction to various kinds of different techniques that people have developed, because for the time-dependent case, there is no, like they say, there are several ways to skin a cat. So like that, you have different ways of actually solving the problem. Okay, so that's why I'm trying to focus on various other things. So this was one. And the other one is actually based on a bipartite lattice. So supposing your Hamiltonian is a bipartite lattice with only the nearest neighbor transfer terms. Then you can actually break up your Hamiltonian into H1 plus H2. H1 is this thing, transfer term, or the Hamiltonian, which involves site, an odd site and an even site. And H2 is one that involves an even site and an odd site. So this will contain like H1, 2, H3, 4, H5, 6, and so forth. And this will contain H2, 3, H4, 5, H6, 7, and so forth. And the nice thing about that is, if you are only having nearest neighbor interactions, transfer, then all the terms within this group commute, and all the terms within this group commute. And because of that, you make very little commutation error when you expand these kinds of operators, exponentials of these operators. So you use a taut decomposition. You take e to the minus iht by h cross, and you write it as e to the minus ih delta t by h cross times n. So this is the taut formula, which becomes exact in the limit n tending to infinity. And you write down for a small time slide delta t, this one in this particular form, h1 delta t by 2, h2 delta t, h1 delta t by 2. Then the error you are making, the taut error in the expansion, is of the order of delta t cube. So if you keep delta t fairly small, then your taut error is acceptable. So now what you do is, given an initial DMRG state, I want to do a time evolution. So if I want to do the time evolution, the given initial state is this one. Okay, some coefficients. This is actually a problem which corresponds to n plus 1, n plus 2, ln minus. So this is actually a L-side problem. Okay, so here I have the density matrix eigenvectors for the left part, and then one new site, another new site, and then the right part. Okay, and these are the coefficients that I've got. Now, if I want to do a time evolution of this one, what I'll do is I'll just time evolve the bond, which is sigma n plus 1 and sigma n plus 2. Okay, so that's only, I only concentrate on the bond, which is connecting the two new sites. So I'm trying to do a finite DMRG calculation. So once I've gone to the infinite DMRG and got the state. From the infinite DMRG, what I'll do is I'll start from the middle, and the middle has got n plus 1 and n plus 2 sites, which are bare sites. Their states have not been put in the density matrix eigenvectors. Only density matrix eigenvectors that you have are that correspond to the left and another correspond to the right, and these two new sites are bare sites. Because of that, you can write down the exponential operator for this particular hn plus 1 comma n plus 2 as u sigma as a matrix, a 4 by 4 matrix if it is a spin-off problem, or a 16 by 16 matrix if it is a fermionic problem. So this sigma n plus 1 and sigma n plus 2 are the states corresponding to the site n plus 1 and site n plus 2, so are tau n plus 1 and tau n plus 2. So now all you do is you have to just multiply this into that one in order to update that particular bond. So I get a new state chi bar delta t, which is the psi at 0 being updated such that only the bond between n plus 1 and n plus 2 sites has been translated in time from 0 to delta t. Okay, from time 0 to time delta t, I have translated it, and the translation just involves this matrix multiplication. That is, the multiplication of this coefficients with the matrix corresponding to the time evolution operator only for those two sites, n plus 1 and n plus 2. And now what I'll do is, I'll use the density matrix algorithm and shift this whole thing to one step to the right. That means what I'll do is, I will convert this chi delta t, which was in this basis of mu n, mu, tau n plus 1, tau prime n plus 2 and mu prime l minus n minus 2, to mu n plus 1, that is I have translated by one side from mu n to mu n plus 1, and then tau n plus 1 now becomes sigma n plus 2 and sigma prime n plus 3, and this one has been reduced by one side. So now I have exposed two sides, which are n plus 2 and n plus 3. Earlier I had exposed n plus 1 and n plus 2, now I am exposing the sides n plus 2 and n plus 3, and I time evolve this one by using the operator corresponding to these sites n plus 2 and n plus 3, which is u sigma n plus 2 sigma n plus 3 tau n plus 2 tau n plus 3. Okay, so bond by bond I am trying to time evolve. Okay, and I can continue this process all the way to the right and then go back and forth, so that I have done one time evolution which has taken me from time 0 to time delta t, because I have exhausted all the bonds in the system. That is, using the zipping in and zipping out mechanism for the finite DMRG, I have exposed one by one the new sites in pairs, and then I have time evolved each one of these pairs states and obtained the time evolution chi delta t. So the process is neat, and you can, the first state that you get, the final state that you get when you time evolve all the bonds is psi delta t, and this can be continued for the next time slice and so forth. The only problem is that it is only very, very limited, because you are only working with Hamiltonians which are bipartite Hamiltonians with only nearest neighbor interactions. So it is a very limited Hamiltonian and of limited appeal. So I don't see many papers based on this one.
So instead of real-time regression, you imagine.
Yeah. That they have done it? Yeah, okay. They have done the imaginary time evolution, because this work was basically done by Tirtho. Yeah.
Okay.
They are comparable? Okay. So, see, I think Davidson algorithm is one of the best that you can think of. Okay, and I have not come across, see, I tried many other techniques, you know, including this Karp-Arrhenius kind of thing for diagonalizing the many body Hamiltonians. None of these techniques are as fast, because just that, you know, this algorithm somehow, the Davidson algorithm is both stable and very fast, and has been used in quantum chemistry literature for almost 40 years now. Is a nine, is I think 1975 algorithm. And in the physics, they were using basically Lanczos algorithm, which actually started in 1950. But there's a modified Lanczos algorithm, which only uses two states. Yeah, but none of those things actually compare as well with that Davidson algorithm. Davidson algorithm is probably one of the best. I don't know, because I don't know how many people have used it to know whether it's but what I know is, I know the modified Lanczos, where they only use two states, or else the Lanczos can be rewound. But you can also do the same rewinding of the Davidson algorithms, and Davidson algorithm is one of the most stable. You can target many excited states simultaneously if you want, whereas Lanczos is basically good for the ground state. Anything more than ground state is very iffy with Lanczos. Okay, what is the basic problem with the time-dependent DMRG methods? The basic problem with the time-dependent DMRG methods is that you start with your full Hilbert space is shown here, and your DMRG Hilbert space for psi 0 is somewhere here. Okay, now you start time evolving it, then very quickly at some later time, the wave function goes out of the DMRG Hilbert space. And because it goes out of the DMRG Hilbert space, the accuracy gets lost. So that's the reason why you cannot have long-time evolutions which are accurate within the static DMRG space. So what?
Even physically, when you go to an excited state, it may not have a matrix product.
Yeah, it may not have a proper representation of the higher excited state will not have sufficient projection onto the DMRG space at time t0. Yeah. But the only thing is that you don't know which excited states are going to enter into the tiny wall state.
But that you are better,
see, what I'm saying is, supposing I start with a wave packet, which corresponds to doping hole on the first side, and I start with a Hamiltonian matrix for the subspace for which I obtain the ground state, okay? Then I don't know how much, what are the states that come in the time evolution of this doped state as compared to the excited states of the neutral Hamiltonian. I have never done the Suzuki Trotter decomposition calculations because, but I think from what I know, there's not too much work involved with the Suzuki Trotter thing except for the initial, papers on that one. So I think Steve White and Shulwak and these people did some of those things. But afterwards, they have gone over to different algorithms. Yeah, so okay. See, most of the times what happens is when you are looking at some of these processes, then you want to time evolve to about 30 femtoseconds to 40 femtoseconds. Because after that, everything kind of becomes smooth. Okay? And this 30 to 40 femtoseconds, you'll have to do in time steps of 0.301 femtosecond kind of thing. Okay? So, which is actually about 10 to the 5 to 10 to the 6 Suzuki Trotter steps you will have to do. Okay, about a million steps that you will have to do. So that is where the problem. So it's an extremely time consuming calculations in this time dependent DMRG calculation. So the idea behind, because you are a Hilbert space of the the time evolved state is very different from the initial Hilbert space, you must keep adapting your DMRG space from time to time. So every time step you have to have a new DMRG state, like at psi 0, psi tp, psi t, and so forth. So the thing that one is actually trying to do these kinds of time, changing with time, is what LXW algorithm did. So for example, LXW algorithm did an average density matrix which involved time evolution over various time steps, okay? And at a given time, it was, this is a slightly different one that I've written down here. This is actually getting many excited states to actually contribute to the average density matrix, but this will not be enough as we will see it. So we tried doing something different, which was actually sliding window or pace keeping or the LXW TDMRG algorithm. So what we did was, instead of doing the time evolution over the entire time t at every size and then constructing your average density matrices, we said that we will do the time evolution for p steps and then p of about 100, and then do the solution when we come to p here, then we make the next time window. So we keep sliding the time window so that we don't have to do the time evolution at every this thing for over the entire time interval, but only over part of the time interval, so that we save time. So we don't have to do very far into the future the time evolution in order to get a better approximation of the time evolution at shorter time. So we only cut it down here and then keep sliding the window to the right. So this is what we did for looking at some of the spin charge separation work that we did earlier. That was about 5 years back. And then there is the time step targeting technique that was actually developed by Faigua and Steve White. And in that, what they do is the following. That is, they first get a approximate space. So supposing you are looking at time t, then you do a Runge-Kutta solution of the time-dependent Schrodinger equation to obtain the solution at time t, t plus tau by 3, t plus 2 tau by 3, and t plus tau. So here I have got the solutions that I have, and this is the Runge-Kutta, fourth order Runge-Kutta solution. So you have the k1, which is h operating upon psi t, and k2, which is again t plus tau by 2 operating upon psi t plus 1 half k1. So this is a standard Runge-Kutta technique. And you can get from that the psi t plus tau by 3, psi t plus 2 tau by 3, psi t plus tau. And use this wave functions as psi t, t plus tau by 3, t plus 2 tau by 3, and t plus tau to construct the average density matrix and propagate the time by an amount which is delta t. And again, at the next step, you do the same calculation and so forth. So at every step, you go about three steps further, obtain the average density matrix, and then go one small step. And then after you go one small step, you again average the density matrix over the next four steps, and then take another tiny step. So like that, you keep propagating. So this is the technique that was developed by Steve White. And the way it is done is actually the finite DMRG procedure. The finite DMRG procedure, what you will do is you keep going from the middle of the site to the end of the site, and when you are going from middle of the site to the end of the site, you are always refining these density matrices at time t, the wave functions at time t, t plus tau by 3, t plus 2 tau by 3, and t plus tau, and then constructing the average density matrix. But when you go to the end of the chain, you advance the time by tau. And now, after advancing the time by tau, now you go backwards. And when you come to the middle of the chain, you again advance the time by another tau, and so on and so forth. So you try to define your density matrices one half of the way when you are going from middle of the chain to the end of the chain. Improve the and then time you all the wave function, and again come back to the middle, and then now time you all the wave function, and so forth. So you don't time you all the wave function at every DMRG step, but you are time evolving at every finite DMRG step, but you are time evolving at the end of every half iteration or so. Of course, you can also do various things like either at half sweep you can do, or you can do it full sweep, and so on and so forth. So if you are looking at time step targeting, the way it will look like is the following. That is, you have delta t. So you have calculated the wave function at t plus delta at t plus delta t by 3, t plus 2 delta t by 3, and t plus delta t. So that, and then you have obtained the average density matrix, and then taken a small step from 0 to 1 in delta tau. The step is only a small step delta tau. And next, your delta t is going to be this one. So your delta t is long, but your delta tau, the translation that you do in time, is small. So every time you have decoupled the time by which you are going to translate your wave function from the time over which you are going to average your density matrix. So the time over which you average the density matrix is delta t, and the time over which you actually take the step is delta tau. And this is pretty accurate, but very time consuming. And then this is a development that Tirtho was the instrumental in. And this is the double time targeting technique. So what it does is actually combines the LXW algorithm together with the algorithm of Feigma and White. And it takes two time windows, which is 2p. And then it does an LXW averaging of the density matrix, and then takes a time step, time translations in units of delta tau until it reaches the end of the first window. When it reaches the end of the first window, it takes the average of the density matrices for times from first window to the third window, once again within the LXW scheme. And is actually a hybrid of LXW and TSC schemes, but at least twice as fast and much more accurate than either of them. So this is what we have. We did the calculations using both the LXW and this is Steve White's algorithm, and we found that our algorithm was faster by at least a factor of two, and also much more accurate. A completely generalized time-dependent DMRG algorithm for any interacting one-dimensional system. So that is the thing about this one. This is for any kind of a one-dimensional system. And in this slide, I have just compared the LXW algorithm with the sliding window algorithm, the time step targeting algorithm of Aigua and White, and then our own double time window algorithm. So it is something that I went through before. So here are some results. And I think it is rather difficult to read from a distance the curves and the details that are given here. But the important thing is that the time step that we have used, delta tau, is 0.066 femtoseconds. And we have done the calculations with M6400 and so forth. And we find that we have calculated the time taken for the time evolution of the charge at first sight. So at the first sight, initially you have doped by hole, so the charge comes down, and then slowly it builds up and again comes back. The hole comes back at this point and so forth. And this is for the 14 sight problem is what we did, because 14 sight problem you can do exact time evolution, model exact time evolution, and also day margin time evolution. And you see that going to one end of the chain from site 1 to site 14, the time taken is this one. For the wave packet to return, is the time taken is this one, and you will see that it takes twice the time to come back. And slowly it kind of damps out. And this is for the spins that I here shown here, spin density S1Z at site 1 and site 14. And these are much more accurate calculations with different cutoffs, and I have done the calculations have been done with a cutoff about 250, and this is just to see how it varies with cutoffs. But the interesting result is actually in the next one. So you can see the time taken for the charge to move from the first site to the last site, which is here, first site to the last site, the charge moves much more rapidly than the spin. The spin takes a much longer time to move because the spin velocities typically depend upon 1 upon j, where j is the exchange constant, whereas the charge velocities typically depend upon 1 upon t, which is the time taken for hopping. Okay, so you see that as you increase u, then of course the time taken for the spin keeps will be now different from the time taken for the charge to move, and you will see here the spin velocities are much more, I mean the charge velocities are faster than the spin velocities. And we tried to look at the ratios for different chain lengths, 20, 30 and 40 sites, for different values of u and for the PPP model. For the PPP model, the ratio of charge velocity to spin velocity is a factor of 2 for the parameters that we have used. So the charge moves twice as fast as the spin. But for Hubble models, it depends upon what u by t you have chosen. And also you see there are very strong finite size effects because the velocity ratios are going to depend upon chain lengths. For example, VH by VL for 20 sites is 1.4, the same ratio is 1.31 here and 1.28. So it's fairly dependent upon the chain length, so we have not overcome the finite size effects.
Sir, I'm saying your chains are finite, I mean they are bounded.
Finite, open boundary. Created a hole at site 1 and then tried to see how the charge of the hole moves and how the spin of the hole moves. So this is, we did some calculation on what happens when you have the dimerization, that is not all the bonds are equal. So you have short bonds and long bonds in your chain, in the PPP chain, and we see that that has some effect on the spin and charge separations. I will not go into the details of that one. For anybody interested, they can actually look up our PRB paper. And we also, so here is basically the ratio of the hole velocity to the spin velocity as a function of the dimerization. You see that the velocity keeps coming down, the ratio keeps coming down. And we also looked at what happens to the polarization and how the polarization moves as a function of the dimerization. But I want to go into another one, that is when we put push and pull groups on two sides of the Pauline chain, and then we want to see whether that's going to have any effect on the spin and charge velocities. And unfortunately the push and pull that you put is actually one electron Hamiltonian matrices. These are the site energies, and because what you are changing are the site energies, you don't see much change in the the whole of the velocity ratios. So it, since it is not a correlation term, it does not make much change. And we also studied another kind of system, which is what is called the polymethane imine chains, that is the CN chains. So you have CHN kind of system, CHNH kind of system. And there is much more complicated, the time evolution. But our basic interest is actually in studying eventually electron hole recombination process in polymers, because that is the one where the dynamics of electron hole recombination and what are the kinds of excited states you will get and what kind of how much triplet you form, how much singlet you form, these are important. And
whether light
emitting diodes, organic light emitting diodes. And also we want to look at it from the point of view of multi exciton generation and so forth. But these are some of the problems that we would like to work on in the future. But this was what we did, was basically kind of trying to standardize our method and show proof of principle that our method works and is very accurate. So that's the reason why we did these calculations. And the, just to summarize, the DMRG technique has been successfully extended to the study of real-time dynamics. Many competing algorithms exist, but all are fairly computer-intensive. Analysis of the results of time-dependent studies is still not fully developed, because you have a whole bunch of oscillations, and you don't know whether these oscillations are real in terms of as Rabe oscillations or whether these are spurious, so you have to be careful. And also, I don't know whether you can actually Fourier transform this and get the spectrum. At least when you do a not just the densities, but density-density correlations, you compute using the time evolution. From the density-density correlations, whether you can get things like the excitation spectrum is still a question. One doesn't know whether one can do that. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Ramsesh. I have a question. People traditionally used to use this time-dependent Hartree formula.
Yeah.
Nuclear physics as well as in chemical. Is that now not very useful?
It's completely uncorrelated picture.
But does it help to gain some understanding, or how much do you gain by these new methods?
Okay.
Brings in new physics.
No, I don't know. Let me see. I'll ask you a different question. That is, how much does Hartree fog allow you to understand the new physics of various systems that you are studying? So it's very doubtful, because explicit correlations are the ones that are very important. So if you do a Hartree fog, you kill all the fluctuations. Once you kill all the fluctuations, all the interesting physics is lost, right? So I think the same thing will happen with a time-dependent Hartree fog.
See, sometimes low energy physics is very strongly modified by correlation.
Correct.
But when it go to excited states, they don't have sufficient time to interact.
Correct.
So some of these old methods might work. That's why I was...
Okay, but what I don't know is that are we really interested in the high excited states in our problems, or whether we are only interested in the lower energy excitation spectrum? Because the higher energy excitation spectrum, for example, would correspond to, in a Hubbard model, all the charges being on one half of the chain. Very high, or like multiply doubly excited states, and doubly charged states.
So no, I'm just provoking you.
Yes.
I know that, for example, things like the spin and charge velocities, which are different.
That is not
get from Hartree fog.
You can't get it. That's why I'm asking you, because that's the reason why. It's valuable, absolutely, because the time-dependent Hartree fog. See, if you. Many people probably might say that, why do you want to do density functional when density functional theory can answer the, you know, all the questions that you have? Why do you want to do it? But my answer is, density functional theory is basically an empirical Hartree fog. Okay, it does not give you any insights. So similarly, if you want to get insights, then you'll have to do.
So then, later question. You mentioned about this multi exciton prediction. Is that also a strong correlation?
Oh yeah. Because multi-exciton generation is basically generation of the triplets from a singlet. So, and the triplets must be such that the singlet energy must be high enough to create two triplets. Triplet energies should not be too low. If it is too low, then the voltage of the open cell voltage of the solar cells, organic photovoltaic cells, will come down. So you want to keep the voltage about one volt. So you want the triplets at about 1 volt, but you want to have the singlets about 2 volts.
So maybe, I'll just make one comment about it. See, I thought that the strong correlation effects are very, for some specific systems at low temperatures and so on. But recently, I also talked to Amsesha that even in solar energy problems, normally you shine light, one photon creates one exciter.
One electron hole pair.
One electron hole pair, and then you separate them. Producing current. But there are situations in which one photon can produce three excitons.
Not directly. What happens is you excite it to the highest singlet state, and there are low-lying triplet states so that you can get more than one triplet. Mm. So, for example, one singlet exciton can create two triplet excitons. And if these triplet excitons separate, you get two electrons and two holes. So which means the current becomes double.
So solar energy becomes.
But as long as the voltage of the triplet state is high enough that you don't lose in terms of voltage, then the power you generate is twice.
And it's amazing. It's a pure strong correlation.
Yeah.
So when we write project, we'll say solar energy.
Absolutely. And you'll get a lot of money. All the money is under the sun. Whether one can use DMRG or not. But if you only have the phenomenon, then unless I can come up with a model to explain the phenomenon, it's difficult for me to say whether DMRG will work.
But I just wanted to add, recently, using DMRG, the tensor electron, people have studied 2D heavy-duty Howard model, optimal Howard model, or TJ model, and they find lots of, in fact, more amplified strike tendencies, charge arrays, and so on. So that has now been attributed as a weakness to some of these methods because it amplifies the small charge array tendency. So there are some interesting exchanges going on.
Sandra,
right, exactly, Sandra. So,
general question, it's not relevant only to DMR. So if you have a very small time scale, like an exponentially small contour scale, would it be possible to capture it in the kind of time scales that we can go to in this
so, see, actually, short time scales is not a problem. The long time scales that becomes a problem.
So, I mean, you would expect that small energy scales would manifest themselves on a longer time scale.
Yeah. Yeah, it depends upon actually what is it that you want to look at. For example, if you are looking at, say, electron hole recombination process, these things occur in a matter of a few femtoseconds because, you know, transfer integral is typically of the order of 1 electron volt, so 1 by T is the time that you are looking at. So it will be of the order of femtoseconds, and these kinds of things can be used for femtoseconds to, you know, maybe 100 femtoseconds if you are very optimistic. But if you are looking at magnetic problems, say for example magnetic tunneling, quantum resonant tunneling that you see in molecules like Mn12, and you want to see what happens to the tunneling, that typically takes place in on a time scale of about 10 to the minus 6 to 10 to the minus 8 seconds, because the rate at which you are ramping magnetic fields there is at about 10 to the power 6 Tesla per second. So in these kinds of situations, techniques of this kind are going to be rather difficult because you'll have to sit pretty on a particular magnetic field for a very, very long time, evolve it, and then increase the magnetic field and so forth. So there are problems in terms of general time evolution problem itself, but you can come up with techniques, but anything that takes more than a picosecond is going to be rather difficult.
And the related question is that problem,
yeah.
Then would you expect that in the time scales that
we are
in the time scales that one can capture in these calculations, would it be possible to see the manifestation of the small energy scales?
Probably. So what you are saying is, I solve my Hamiltonian for one set of parameters, and suddenly change the parameters of the Hamiltonian and want to see how the ground state is going to evolve.
Right.
So it's a sudden approximation.
Right. And And in the solution of the ground state that you did it for, let's say,
Original parameters.
Yeah, for the original parameters. Let's say there is a small time scale. There's a small energy scale, I'm sorry, not a time scale, small energy scale. Would you see the manifestation of that in any way in the short time scale that you're being able to go on? I mean,
it's something that you have to work and see.
Suppose you do a sudden approximation.
Yes.
So what are the eigenstates? How do they project onto the spectrum here?
Yeah.
Correct.
So if the sudden approximation you've done has a large projection on the small energy excited states that you're thinking about, then everything is gone.
So, but there, you know, actually one need not go through these kinds of procedures because once you have your new Hamiltonian, you have the eigenstates of that one, and then express your wave packet initial state in terms of the eigenstates and do a time evolution, which is much easier to do.
So, I think we are keeping
it. Yeah.
Yeah,
okay.
Thank you, sir. So, we'll adjourn for the impact at 11:30 unless under